Would you turn with me in your hymnal to 395, 395 in my heart. There rings a melody. Let's all stand together as we sing. 395, let's sing that first together.
I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. There's a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love.
I love the Christ who died on Calvary.
For he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody. And I know it's there to stay. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. 'Twill be my endless theme in glory. With the angels I will sing. 'Twill be a song with glorious harmony. When the chords of heaven ring. In my heart there rings a melody.
Good singing this morning. Welcome to the morning service. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers, and I hope it'll be a special day for you. We do have a gift for you this morning, and we'll make sure you have that before you leave today. But let's bow together and pray and ask God to meet with us this morning. Father, we bow before you in prayer today, and we do thank you, Lord, for another Lord's Day that you brought us to, and particularly, Lord, this particular Sunday, which is set aside to celebrate mothers. And Lord, we thank you for the influence that mothers have in our lives, Lord. And those of us who have had the blessing of having a godly mother, and Lord, we thank you for that. And Lord, I pray that those who are in this room, and whether they're a mother or a grandmother or an aunt or whatever they may be, or just a surrogate grandmother or mother to someone, that Lord, you'll minister to our hearts today and give us all what we need this morning in our church service. May each one yield themselves to you. May you minister to us as only you can. And we pray and ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, you may be seated. This is Sarah and her daughter Carly. They're going to sing, and Josiah is going to accompany them. This is brother and sister. These are Cindy's son and daughter and granddaughter. And they're singing a song, I believe, that your mom used to sing with her when she was that age. And now they're singing it for us this morning, so you'd be blessed by this.
First a child says, Mommy, then ball or book or bite. Then they grow to wonder, and soon they're asking why. So hurriedly we answer, with much in mind to do. We haven't time to give them, even when they ask us who. There's not much time once more. We We fed them, sent them out to play, and now on to their rooms. But still no time to give them when they ask again so soon. Children have in mind. There's precious and few moments as days leap into years. So take the time to tell them who this Jesus really is. Child, this man Jesus, your friends all tell you about. He died because he loves you. Come here and we'll find out.
Amen.
Let's read it in our Bible book, the word so true and pure. And there are many stories here to help us know for sure.
Well, let's turn to 311 in our hymnal. 311, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed, how I love you. Let's sing that first together.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy. In shout and forever I am.
Listen carefully now. We have a few announcements for you. And no 5:30 class tonight. We'll resume that class again on May 22nd, all right? But we'll have the evening service at 6:30 right back here in the auditorium. And Lord willing, tonight I'm going to talk about strengths and weaknesses. As you grow in your life, you're aware of things that you're good at and things that you're not so good at. All right, and how does God use that in our life, and how does God use that in the church family? And so we'll look at that this evening at 6:30. Right after the service tonight, the teens are going to have a fundraiser for, they're going to have nachos. What do you have, a nachos and, is it nacho night? Is that what you're calling it? nacho and Coney dogs, all right, and drinks, and that'll be right after the service tonight. So plan to stay around, have some fellowship and some great food, and be part of that after the service this evening, all right? So hope you take Mom out to dinner or make a dinner for her today and let her relax, and then treat her tonight after the service to a snack after church, all right? Something about being in church that makes you hungry. I don't know what that is, but it works that way, doesn't it? And yeah, I mean, how many, when you get out of church, you think, man, I'm hungry. Anybody like that? Huh? Okay. The rest of you aren't being honest, are you? And how many of you just say, I'm hungry all the time? It doesn't have to be church. Yeah, okay, there you go. Now I found your level. All right, there you go. All right, so we look forward to a great time together tonight. Remember the flyers in the conference room for our country fair coming up on May 21st. I think we're just over 6,000 here in the first week, and that's not bad, just a little bit under where I'd like to see us be. So we have to continue to work at it this week, all right? And wonder if we picked up 1,000 hot dog buns yesterday, and working on getting the hot dogs to go in them. Right now, I think we've got a few hundred that have been donated to us, and so things are starting to come in, and the community helping us to be a blessing to the community on that day. So it's going to be a great, great time together. And next Sunday evening, by the way, next Sunday morning, we'll have Brother Ben Burks, Benjamin Burks, and his wife Wendy. She'll be speaking Saturday at the mother-daughter luncheon. And then he'll be with us Sunday morning, and he'll be preaching next Sunday morning. He's the international director of Reformers Unanimous. And so make sure you're here. Don't miss him next Sunday. You'll be blessed by having the Burks with us. And then we'll continue getting the flyers out for the country fair on 21st. Next Sunday evening at 5:55, we'll have our organizational meeting for the country fair. All right? And no need to volunteer. You've been volunteered, okay? If you're here and you're a regular attender here, we'll assign you to help somewhere, all right? And you'll be part of that on May 21st. So plan on that and clear out your day for that day. And let's use it to reach our community for Christ that Saturday, okay, and be a blessing to families, all right? Now, let's take just a moment, and we'll recognize any guests we have with us in the service today. We're always pleased when folks visit with us. Did I see Barb back there? I did, didn't I? Good to see you again, Barb. Thank you for being here. And anybody else today visiting for the very first time, or you got a guest with you? I think Brother Chuck has a guest right over here. Go ahead, Chuck. Amen. Congratulations, Brent. That's great. Good to have you this morning, Brent. Thank you for coming. If you'll take just a minute and fill out the guest card there that you received, a little bit we have the offering. You just put that card in the plate if you would, and keep the pen as our gift to you for coming. We're glad you're here this morning. All right. Anybody else here this morning? It's good to see Eric and Crystal Lissa back there. Came down for Mom's Day, and glad you're here from Brunswick. And thank you for being here. Anyone else? Okay, Josiah and Kate are here for Mother's Day, and glad they're here with their family, and that's wonderful. All right. Well, let's give our guests a warm welcome, shall we?
With no.
231, if you would. 231, down in the valley with my Savior I would go. 231. We're going to sing the first and last together. On that first. Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the flowers are blooming and the sweet waters flow. Everywhere he leads me, I would follow on, walking in his footsteps till the crown be won. Follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere he leads me, I would follow on. As we sing that last, we'll have the children go out to junior church. Children, you're dismissed to junior church. Let's sing that last together. Down in the valley or upon the mountain steep, close beside my Savior would my soul ever keep. He will lead me safely in the path that he has trod, up to where they gather on the hills of God. I would follow Jesus anywhere, everywhere. I would follow on. Follow, I would follow Jesus. Everywhere he led me, I would follow on. Amen. Great singing this morning. Would you turn back to 56, number 56? The old rugged cross. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. Would you stand with me as we sing on that first together? 5-6. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophy that last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross, then exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophy that last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Let's sing that last together. Did you find your seats? To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross, then exchange it someday for a crown. Let's sing that chorus one more time. We're going to sing that without the instruments. Let's sing that chorus one more time. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Amen.
All right, be seated if you will. The ushers are coming and we'll get our offering this morning. Be prepared to give as God has blessed and prospered you throughout the week. And if you have a card that you filled out this morning, just put that in the offering if you would, and we'll have a record of your visit with us today. We're glad you're here. Let's pray, and we'll ask God's blessing on our offering this morning. Brother Polabo, I'd like you to lead us in prayer, please.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us, where we can come in and hear the word of God preached, and pray that we'd be hearers of the word as well as doers of the work. And we do pray that you'd be with the pastor as he preaches, fill him with the Spirit. We ask that you'd give him the message that you want each one of us to have. And we just pray for the offering now that it be spent wisely. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Take your Bible this morning, if you would, for our scripture reading. Do 2 Kings chapter 4, please. 2 Kings chapter 4, if you would please. Second Kings chapter 4, we're going to read three verses, verses 8, 9, and 10. Read 8 together. I'll read verse 9, then we'll read 10 together this morning. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 8 of 2 Kings chapter 4. Ready? And it fell on a day that Elisha passed to Shunem, where was a great woman, and she constrained him to eat bread. And so it was that as oft as he passed by, he turned in thither to eat bread. And she said unto her husband, Behold now, I perceive that this is an holy man of God, which passeth by us continually. Let us make a little chamber, I pray thee, on the wall, and let us set for him there a bed, and a table, and a stool, and a candlestick. And it shall be, when he cometh to us, that he shall turn in thither. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of the scripture now here this morning. We thank you, Lord, again for the opportunity that's ours to gather together here freely in a country where we have the liberty to do so. And Lord, we're bowing here and thanking already for what we've heard this morning. Thank you for the wonderful music and the messages in these songs that we've heard sung and that we have sung together. And Lord, we're asking you now that you'll quieten our hearts, that you will prepare us to be able to listen and to hear what the Spirit would say to his church this morning. Holy Spirit, be our guide now today, and I pray that you'll use the special to turn our eyes upon you and to tune our hearts to thee. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Come unto me, and I will give you rest. But I have seen him, though never with my eyes, and he is near me, so tender and so wise. I felt his arms around me, and his touch has made me whole. I know I've seen him in my spirit and my soul. Oh, blessed are ye who have not seen yet believe. I've seen him and he's with me in my spirit and my soul. My soul.
Amen. Amen. That's good. The song that Sarah and Carly sang earlier, I found out was written by Cindy years ago. So what a blessing that was today. Father, we thank you now for your love for us, and thank you, God, for your word that we have to open up this morning and to look upon. And we ask you to bless and honor again the preaching of your word. Lord, I pray that you would help us to not be distracted this morning, but help us to be focused on what you would want to say to each of us this morning. Lord, I pray that you'd move up and down the aisles today and in and out of each individual row, and that you would stop at every occupied seat, that you'd minister to your people today as only you can do. Holy Spirit of God, work in every heart, please. Help me as I bring the message, and please help the folks as they listen today. May your will be accomplished in each and every life. And I'll thank you now in advance for what I believe you'll do in our hearts. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you turn that back on now, Nathan, I'd appreciate that. One of the first names ever heard by human ears was the name Mother. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse 20, Adam called his wife's name what? Eve, because she was the mother of all living. And so the most first name of the woman in the Bible was the name of Mother, the mother of all living. An old Spanish proverb says, an ounce of mother is worth a pound of clergy. I think there's a lot of truth to that. You know, there's some great mothers in the Bible. Eve, of course, and I think of Mrs. Noah and her boys that she got into the ark, and think of Hannah with Samuel and Jochebed with Moses, Elizabeth with John the Baptist, and of course the earthly mother of Jesus, Mary. But none of those women were called great. Only one in the Bible is called a great woman. And it's interesting, it's the woman we read about this morning, and if you have your Bible open to 2 Kings 4, we're going to be looking at that passage today. And it's interesting, her name isn't given. But by the way, that's indicative of a mother. You take the M off of mother, and what do you have? Others. That's what the old-fashioned mother was all about. The old-fashioned mother was never about herself. She was always about others. Taking care of her children, taking care of her husband, taking care of others. Other people may get shoes, but mom would wait. Other people may get clothes, but mom would wait. She always thought of others ahead of herself. Oh, that God would give us mothers again in our country. Now, she was called a great woman. That's all it says. And as you read together with me in verse number 8, it simply said that Elijah passed to Shunem, where was a great woman. And I don't know if she was great because of her wealth. I don't know if she was great because of her morality or her virtue. It may have been her compassion or her faith. But We're going to spend some time with this Shunammite woman and find out a little bit what made her great in the sight of God. The great thing about the Bible is when God gives these comments about what makes people great, we can say, you know what, if we can have these ingredients, if we can follow their pattern, then maybe I can be great in the sight of God as well. And you have to understand about this woman, her name isn't important, or else God would have given it to us. But she was just living her life. She had no idea that she was going to end up on the pages of Scripture, and thousands of years later, we'd be talking about her. She had no clue. She was just living her life as she felt like God wanted her to live it, and God said, there's greatness. And let me just say this, oftentimes we don't realize greatness when we're living with it. A lot of times you don't realize how great somebody was until they are no longer with you. And then you begin to recognize their greatness. Let's look at this lady this morning from Shunem, she's known as the Shunammite woman. I want you to notice, first of all, her compassion. Her compassion. We read about verse number 8, where it fell on a certain day, Elisha the prophet, he passed to Shunem, where was a great woman. Notice she constrained him to eat bread. And so it was that as oft as he passed by, he turned in thither to eat bread. They lived on a route. And you understand, in those days, as people would travel, they didn't have motels they stopped at. They didn't have restaurants to stop at like you do when you plan your trip or you plan your vacation. They just had to rely on the hospitality of people along the way. And this woman, as travelers would come by, she would invite them for a meal. And she was one of these ladies who didn't take no for an answer. When she invited you to stay for dinner, you were coming for dinner. And you were going to eat with her. And it was. And by the way, a meal to them was much different than a meal is to us. A meal to them is very important. It was a big deal. And breaking bread, by the way, conversation was more important to them than it is to us. That was a very important part of them learning things and understanding things and getting news from other places and finding out about other places. They would spend hours in conversation because it was informative to them. And so she would have these travelers come in and talk to them and get to know them. And one of the ones that came by frequently was this man named Elisha. Elisha followed Elijah as a prophet. And now he's taken up that office. And as he travels through, he stops and she constrains him to eat a meal. And then notice she didn't have to constrain him twice. Most preachers, you don't. Once you invite him for a meal, it's a done deal. He'll stop every time. Amen. And so he stops and he begins to eat. And after frequent meals with him, and by the way, conversations with him, she says to her husband, I perceive that this is a man of God. I perceive this is really a man of God. It could have been because of his prayers. It could have been because of the conversation over the meal. It could have been just the way he carried himself, maybe the way he treated others. But she asked her husband something very specific. You know, I was talking to my brother-in-law yesterday. We went up to celebrate Mother's Day with my mom, and who's 89 years young, and Tuesday had a stent put in one of her arteries in her heart, and went home Wednesday to her own house and stayed by herself and looked great yesterday and had to get together with the family and was doing wonderful. And I thought, my brother-in-law, you know, whenever your wife says, fellas, can you relate? Whenever your wife says, you know, I've been thinking. You know what's coming? What's coming is you got work to do. That's what's coming, all right? You get ideas and then you got work to do. Well, so that she had that conversation. She goes, honey, I've been thinking. And he said, okay. How much will this cost me? And what do I need to be doing? She goes, I think we ought to add an addition to our house. I think we just need to add a room. Okay, what for? Well, I think we ought to add a room for the prophet Elisha. And we need to, it doesn't have to be fancy. We're just going to put a room in there. We're going to put a bed so he can rest. We're going to put a desk and a chair so he can study. And we'll put a candlestick there. So he can sleep and he can rest and he can also read and study. And that way, whenever he passes by, he can eat and he can rest. And that's where, by the way, that's where the word prophet's chamber came from. It came from this passage right here in 2 Kings chapter 4. And so they built that addition onto their house and furnished it with a bed and a table and a stool and a candlestick. That's compassion in action. That's understanding the needs of somebody and wanting to be a help and a blessing to someone else. In this case, Elisha, the man of God. So apparently, she was a woman, or come from her husband and her, had some means, but they used their means to be a blessing to other people. They used those means to be a blessing, in this case, to the man of God and to Elisha, the prophet. And hey, to build an addition on your home is no passing fancy. Okay, anybody ever done that? Build a room on or build an addition on? Okay, that's not something you say, hey, let's do that and tomorrow it's done. Okay, you're going to take some planning and it's going to take some work. It's no flash in the pan event. But her thoughtfulness, her compassion, her willingness to help was not a flash in the pan thing. It wasn't an impulse thing. It was a principled thing. And she was going to be, and she, that's the way she was. And she had compassion. So I think she was great because of her compassion. I don't think she ever tired of meeting the needs of other people. That's a mother, by the way. That's a mother. The old-fashioned mother, listen to me, the old-fashioned mother that cared about others and cared about her family, she wasn't trying to get a break from her family. She couldn't get enough of her family and wanted to be around them and wanted to be with them. So I see her compassion. But the second thing that's great about this woman is her contentment. Would you look at verses 12 and 13 with me? So here's what happens. Verse 12, he said unto Gehazi, his servant, call this Shunammite. And when he had called her, she stood before him. And he said, that's Elisha, say now unto her, behold, thou hast been careful for us with all this care. What is to be done for thee? Wouldest thou be spoken for to the king or to the captain of the host? And she answered, I dwell among mine own people. I see her contentment. Listen, Elisha says, gets Gehazi one day, he said, what have we offered to do for this lady because she built us this nice room? And Gehazi said, well, we haven't done anything. Call her in here. And he said, listen, Shunammite woman, I know the king. We're on a first name basis. I know the captain of the army. I mean, I know some people. What would you like? I can get you some favors. I can get you some things done. And he's offering her maybe a position, maybe a step up somewhere, maybe to have some influence in the affairs of the country. We don't know. But he says, I'm willing to do a favor for you since you've been so good to me. And you know what she said? I live right here. Not looking for anything else. Not looking to move up. Not looking for greener pastures. I'm just happy where I am. I dwell among my people. You know what that is? That's contentment. That's contentment. That's a hard word for Americans to get. It kind of sticks in our throat, doesn't it? Huh? Content with such things as you have. I wonder how many people have taken the promotion only to regret it. I wonder how many people have taken the transfer and regretted it. I wonder how many people have built the bigger house and regretted it. I wonder how many people have moved only to regret it. Paul told Timothy, his preacher boy, he said, Timothy, understand something. Godliness with contentment is great gain. You gain a lot of ground. You gain something invaluable when you couple your godliness with contentment. Be content with such things as ye have. Listen, her mind, her heart was not set on earthly treasures. She was interested in heavenly treasures. A preacher lived in New York City and would often ride the subway. After one particularly difficult day, he's riding the subway home, and it was getting very irritating to him that at every stop, as the doors opened, they creaked and groaned on their hinges. And he watched as a plain, ordinary-looking man said out loud, looking at the door, "I think I can fix this." And to his amazement, he says the fella pulled out of his coat pocket an oil can. And he oiled the hinges on that subway door. And the noise was gone. But the preacher thought to himself, "That's it. I ought to never leave home without an oil can in my pocket." Now, not a physical oil can necessarily, but I could always make sure I leave home with the oil can of kindness, with the oil can of an encouraging word, with the oil can of forgiveness, with the oil can of long-suffering, with the oil can of a helping hand. I could always leave home ready to help with somebody's problem. Now, contentment, as we know from Paul, is a learned behavior. Paul said, "I've learned whatsoever state I'm in, therewith to be content." So it's something we learn to be content. To be content and to learn it, you have to get two things down. Number one, you have to discipline your desire for things. And again, that is difficult for Americans to do, because things are so accessible to us. We have a difficult time learning to live simply. Learning to downsize, if you will. Very difficult to do. Most Americans, most Americans will have about $1,000 worth of junk crammed into the garage, and then $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 vehicles parked outside. Or we've got so much stuff in our homes that we have to go down to the road and get a storage facility and pay somebody to keep more of our stuff. Because we got more than what we can fit into what we built. Kind of like that fellow who said, "What am I going to do with all this stuff? I'm going to have to tear down these barns and build bigger." So why? You can collect more stuff. And it's become a business. I remember years ago meeting a fellow at a flea market. Brother Lindemann, he worked Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. He worked 3 days a week. And he told me he averaged $380 a day. Flea market. That's not a bad gig if you can get it, is it? $1,000 a week, work 3 days a week. How many would take that job? Yeah. Unbelievable. On doing what? Selling people's stuff. Just selling their junk, because we have so much. Why do we get so much? Because, we got to have this. Oh, no, I have this one, but this is a new and improved one. This is better now, and I got to get the newest one. And we keep gathering more things. And sometimes people do it thinking, "I'll just have to get this, and I'll be content. If I can just get one of these, then I'll be happy. If I can get a bigger house, then I'll be..." And we keep chasing the carrot and never arrive at contentment. Learn to live simply. Learn to be content with such things as you have. Secondly, not only do you have to discipline your desire for things, and by the way, let me just say this before I go on to number two. One of the best things you can ever do is when you really want something, you desire something, especially if it's a purchase, just tell yourself, "I'm going to wait 3 days and then see if I still want it." And you know, you find yourself after about 3 days, you think, "Glad I didn't buy that." Because now you don't even want it. It's not a big deal. So if ever there's a salesman that says, "Now this is it. This is the, you got to sign tonight, or the offer's no good," I say, "Well, then the offer's no good. Because we're not signing tonight." We never do something impulse. How many ever did something on impulse, you regretted it later? Huh? Yeah? If you're over 12, you've done that probably. The second principle about contentment is this: accept the inevitable and the unavoidable. Accept the inevitable and the unavoidable. Things happen in life. You have to learn to accept it. Why? Because He does all things well. He does all things well. Who's in control of my life? God is. and he brings things into my life and he takes things away. What did Job say? The Lord gave and the Lord taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The Lord, we do, the Lord gave and the Lord take away. God, what are you doing? That's how we say it. And Job said, blessed be the name of the Lord. You see, I'm going to accept what God gives to me. Have you ever just told God, Lord, do as you want to my life. I trust you. Do what you want to my life. I trust you. Contentment. Contentment with what God gives you. So I see the compassion of this lady. I see the contentment of this great woman. But then, don't miss this. This is great. This is her confession. Notice, let's go. When she said, I dwell among my people. Verse 14. He said, what is then to be done for her? Gehazi answered, verily she hath no child. Her husband's old. And he said, call her. And when he called her, she stood in the door. And he said, about this season, according to the time of life, thou shalt embrace a son. And she said, nay, my Lord, thou man of God, do not lie unto thy handmaid. And the woman conceived and bare a son at that season that Elijah had said unto her, according to the time of life. And so he says, all right, what's he need? And Gehazi said, hey, you know what she really would like? She'd like to have a son. Now, she never said that. But just observing, I think he must have perceived that was something that was on her heart. And when it says her husband was old, I take it almost like it was just like when Abraham was old and they were past childbearing time. And so Elisha says, you're going to have a baby. She's like, man, don't lie to me. And of course, it came exactly to pass. She had a young boy. Now, that little boy began to grow and he got old enough to be out on his own. And he's out in the field with his dad and he says, my head hurts, my head hurts. And of course, dad did what any dad does. He said, take him to his mom. And the servant said, okay. And they took him inside to his mom. And she saw he was hot. Maybe just been out in the sun too long. Maybe just needs to cool off. Maybe she got some cool cloths and put on his head. She kept him on his knee and she hugged him. But as she held him there and held her on her knee, the Bible says that the life just continued to go out of him until he died there on her lap. And she picked that little boy up and she carried him up to Elisha's room, to the prophet's chamber. And she laid him on his bed, closed the door, and then she went to one of the servants and she said, you get the animal saddled there. And says, we're going to go see the man of God. And as she got ready to go see the man of God, her husband said, what's going on? It's no feast day or no special time. What's going on? And she said, let's read it. Let's read what she said, okay? Verse number 23. He said, that's her husband, wherefore wilt thou go to him today? It's neither new moon or Sabbath. And she said, it shall be well. Isn't that amazing? I'll tell you what that is. That's a tremendous confession of her faith in God. It shall be well. How many of you ladies would have said, our son is dead. He's in the house. I put him on his bed. I'm going to get Elisha. Man, pray for him. I don't know what's going to happen. There's a word for that. It's called freaking out. And that's probably what most people would have done. But you know what? She didn't react. She responded. And she put her faith into action. She saddled an ass and said to her servant, drive and go forward. Slack not thy riding for me, except I bid thee. Boy, every husband would like to have his wife say that about his driving, wouldn't it? So she went and came unto the man of God to Mount Carmel. And when it came to pass, when the man of God saw her far off, he said to Gehazi, his servant, behold, yonder is the Shunammite. Run now, I pray thee, to meet her, and say unto her, is it well with thee? Is it well with thy husband? Is it well with the child? And she answered, what, church? It is well. Are you kidding me? That's incredible. Is that what you would have said? Amazing her faith that she has. When she came to the man of God to the hill, she caught him by the feet, but Gehazi came near to thrust her away. And the man of God said, let her alone. her soul is vexed within her, and the Lord hath told, Lord hath hid it from me and hath not told me. Then she said, did I desire a son of my Lord? Did not I say, do not deceive me? Then said he to Gehazi, gird up thy loins, take my staff in thine hand, go thy way. If any man meet thee, salute him not. And if any man salute thee, answer him not again, and lay my staff upon the face of the child. And the mother of the child said, as the Lord liveth, as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And he arose and followed her. Gehazi passed on before them and laid the staff on the face of the child. But there was neither voice nor hearing, wherefore he went again to meet him. And he told him, saying, the child is not awaked. When Elisha was coming to the house, behold, the child was dead and laid upon his bed. And he went in therefore and shut the door upon them twain and prayed unto the Lord. When he went up and laid upon the child and put his mouth upon his mouth, his eyes upon his eyes, his hands upon his hands, he stretched himself upon the child, and the flesh of the child waxed warm. And he returned and walked in the house to and fro, and went up and stretched himself upon him, and the child sneezed 7 times, and the child opened his eyes. And he called Gehazi and said, call this Shunammite. So he called her, and when she was come in unto him, he said, take up thy son. And she went in and fell at his feet, and bowed herself to the ground, and took up her son and went out. She was promised a son, and according to the time of life, she had a boy. And when he falls sick and ends up dying, she immediately goes to Elisha. She immediately goes to the man of God. Let me just say this, Mom and Dad. There'll come a day when you're going to need the preacher. There'll come a day when something will come in your life and you're going to need the man of God. One of the tragedies in our day is we have so many folks who they don't have any church home, they don't have any church family, but tragedy comes to every home. Difficulty comes to every home. And then they have nobody to go to. Nobody to talk to. And listen to me, I'm not opposed to all TV preachers or radio preachers. I know a guy who has a radio on the radio. But listen, when there is a problem, when there is a difficulty, you're going to have a hard time running to the radio preacher. You're going to have a hard time calling up that TV evangelist you like so well and saying, come, my son is ill. Come, my son is sick. I need you to pray for him. See how that works out with your nationally known or your television preacher that you like so well. There'll come a day when your children needs the preacher. And of course, her confession, when he says, is all well with your husband, is all well with your son. And she says, it is well. That's an amazing statement. It shows how what a great confession of faith she had. And it had to be faith because sight wasn't looking too good. If I just looked at the way it really looked on this side, I'd have said, man, things are not good. Things are not well because my son is dead. I like the fact Elisha said, Gehazi, you go check it out. And you know what? She didn't go with Gehazi. She held on to Elisha and said, if you think I'm settling for him, I came to get you. And I'm not settling for anything but you. And so finally Elisha says, I've got to go too. And he comes and he brings that boy back to life. Now listen, we live in a day, and let me just bring it down to home. We live in a day in America where our homes are in trouble. Would I be exaggerating to say there's death in our homes? There's death in our homes that need, listen, because we need to point our homes back to God. God is the giver of life. And if you don't have God in your home, you don't have life in your home. It's deadness. The Bible says about that woman who, in 1 Timothy 5, the widow who's young and unmarried, said, she that liveth in pleasure is dead while she lives. And those who live for the pleasure of the world, and those who live for whatever it pleases me to do, whatever I feel like doing, listen to me, my friend, you're dead while you live. There's no way to live. The way to live is to live for God. The way to live is to live for Jesus Christ. And the answer to America's problems, and America has her problems, but the answer is not going to be in a better politician. The answer is not going to be in a better president. The answer is not even going to be in a better education. And the answer, by the way, the answer won't even be in a better church. The answer is in better homes. The churches will never be better until the homes get better. Because it's the homes that determine the church. And so we have to get God back in our home. You won't lose your children, and you won't have your children go astray from God because of the church they were in. They go astray, not because of what they had on Sunday morning, Sunday night, or Wednesday night. What did they have on Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday? What did they see in the home? Mother, is it well with you this morning? Are you the godly mother that you ought to be? You know, children, they're going to forget the color of carpet you had in the house. They'll forget the arrangement of the furniture. In fact, they'll probably forget most of the meals you've ever made. But they will not forget the prayers that you pray. And they will not forget the Bible that you taught them. A dad took his little girl out on a fishing trip on a lake, and they went out 5 or 6 miles from the shore and dropped 2 anchors and let out the fishing lines. They caught some fish. They ate some sandwiches. They read stories. They had a great time. They both fell asleep. And they awoke to water splashing them in the face, and it was beginning to rain. Quickly brought the anchors up, and Dad began to row the boat towards the shore. He rowed backwards so he could face the little girl, not wanting her to be alarmed or to be fearful. And he asked her, "Do you see the shore?" And she said, "No." She said, "Daddy, are we lost?" And of course, "No, honey, no." And he kept on rowing. And after he rowed for some time and he was getting a little concerned, his little girl said to him, "Daddy," she said, "I see a light over your shoulder. Mama said that if we got in after dark, she'd put a light in the window." And Daddy said, "Honey, just steer Daddy towards that light, will you?" And she kept telling him and steering him towards that light. And he said a short time later, he felt the bottom of that boat grate the shore. And he jumped out and pulled that boat out of the water, tied it up, grabbed that little girl in his arms, ran up to the house and come in the door and deposited that girl back into the arms of her mother. And the mother said, "Well, I was beginning to worry about you two." And the little girl said, "Mom, you didn't have to worry. We were steered by your light." Is it well with you? Is it well with your husband? Is it well with your children? If you're here this morning, and you may be here in this audience, and your mother steered you right, she did give you a light to follow, and you veered off the path, and you've gone your own way, let me tell you something this morning. What'll mean more to your mother than all the candy and flowers and gifts you could give her? It'd be a life lived for God. For you to come and say, I'm mother, I'm dedicating my life to follow Christ today. That'd mean more to her than any gifts you'd ever give her, any presents you'd ever want to present. Now, the great thing about this woman of Shunammite, let me give you the rest of the story, okay? Turn over to 2 Kings chapter 8. 2 Kings chapter 8. Go forward a few chapters, will you? Notice verse number 1. "Then spake Elisha unto the woman, whose son he had restored to life." So who's he talking to? Shunammite woman. "Arise and go thou in thine household and sojourn wheresoever thou can sojourn, for the Lord hath called for a famine, and it shall also come upon the land 7 years. And the woman arose and did after the saying of the man of God, and she went with her household and sojourned in the land of the Philistines 7 years. And it came to pass at the 7 years' end, the woman returned out of the land of the Philistines, and she went forth to cry unto the king for her house and for her land." Now, she said, okay, 7 years is up. I'm coming back home. I'm going to go to the king and try to get my land back that I left. And as she goes to petition the king, guess who's there? Gehazi, Elisha's servant. And guess what they're talking about? The king asked Gehazi, tell me about Elisha and all the miracles he'd done. And so he's telling the king the story of the woman whose son he brought back to life. And here she comes. What a coincidence. How lucky. No. Not at all. Let's see what happens. The king talked with Gehazi, the servant, the man of God, saying, tell me, I pray thee, all the great things that Elisha hath done. And it came to pass, as he was telling the king how he had restored a dead body to life, that behold, the woman whose son he had restored to life cried to the king for her house and for her land. And Gehazi said, my lord, O king, this is the woman, and this is her son whom Elisha restored to life. And when the king asked the woman, she told him so. So the king appointed unto her a certain officer, saying, restore all that was hers and all the fruits of the field since the day that she left the land even until now. Wow. Huh? Do you think God rewards faith? Do you think God honors faith? Do you think this lady was glad she believed God? What a great woman. What a great woman. Great because of compassion. Great because of her contentment. But great because of her confession of faith. She walked by faith, not by sight. I pray God would help all of us to have these ingredients in our life. Let's pray, shall we? Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank you, Lord, for this Shunammite woman. What a blessing. What a testimony. And Lord, though thousands of years have passed, we've enjoyed spending some time learning about her life here this morning. And Lord, I want you to speak to the heart of every woman here, that they would realize if they can be compassionate, they can show and help others as she wanted to help passersby and help others along their way. And she especially was kind to the man of God. And then contentment. Oh, how often we get discontent with the things you've given us. Father, help us to learn contentment and to know that godliness with contentment is great gain. And help us to pray today to ask you to help us to be content with such things as we have. And Father, her confession of faith, I pray that every woman here this morning would have a confession of faith that Jesus Christ is their Savior. That they've trusted Him to forgive their sin. To give them the gift of eternal life. And then they would live by faith. They would trust God for their family and trust God. Their light would be a shining light for their family to be guided by. She would be the mother of the home. Father, minister and speak to hearts today as only you can. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. But right now, just between you and God, I wonder how many folks here this morning would say, Pastor, I know that if I died this morning, I'm 100% sure that I'd go to heaven. There's a time in my life when I knew I was a sinner, I needed a Savior, and Jesus Christ was the Savior I needed. And I know that if I died today, I'd go to heaven because I am trusting Jesus Christ as my Savior today. Would you slip your hand up as a testimony and say, Pastor, that's me. I know that I'm saved. Okay, you may put it down. You're here today and would say, Pastor, I don't know for sure that if I died, I'd go to heaven. I don't know that I've ever called on the Lord and I'd ask Him to be my Savior. Would you let me pray for you? Not embarrass you. I'll not call you out, but I will pray for you. That the Lord will continue to work in your heart. Would you slip your hand up now and say, Pastor, pray for me this morning? I couldn't raise it the first time, but I'll raise it now. Pray for me, please. Okay, I don't think I saw anybody's hand who didn't go up. The message was to believers, and particularly this great woman. I wonder how many ladies here this morning would say, Preacher, God spoke to my heart today. Doesn't matter who I am. Doesn't matter what my name is. I can be great in God's sight with compassion, with contentment, and with my confession of faith. Pastor, the Spirit of God did stop at my seat today, and He ministered to my heart. And I'd like you to pray for me this morning. Would you slip your hand up, ladies? Say, pray for me today. Yes. Amen. Amen. You may put them down. Are there others here today who would say, Pastor, the Lord has dealt with my heart this morning? You may not be a lady. You may not be a mother. But you know, I find that God has different ways of speaking to us and different things in a message that the Spirit of God will take to our heart that we're not even aware of. And maybe the Spirit of God spoke to your heart today and say, Preacher, God's dealing with me about something and I appreciate you praying with me about it. Would you slip your hand up and say, Pastor, pray for me? God bless you. God bless you. And God bless you over here. Thank you. Appreciate that. In a moment, I'm going to pray and then we'll have our invitation. When I'm done praying, we'll stand to our feet. When we stand to our feet, the pianist will begin to play. And when she plays, Bob will sing the invitation. God has spoken to your heart this morning. That's time for you to respond and come to the altar and bow your knee to the Lord. And tell Him what He's been dealing with your heart about. And bow the knee to Him. If you're here today and you've never received Christ as your Savior, you ought to come. And while others are praying, let us have someone take a Bible and show you how you can know you're on your way to heaven. If you're here today and maybe you've received Christ as your Savior, somebody maybe came to your home and you prayed and asked Christ to be your Savior, then you ought to come and let me tell the people that you received Christ as your Savior that you're not ashamed of that decision. And if you're saved and you've ever been scripturally baptized, that's the next step you take. Once you're saved, you follow the Lord in baptism to show that you believe He died, was buried, and rose again for you. Whatever it is that God's dealt with your heart about, I want you to obey Him this morning. Heavenly Father, have your way in this invitation now. May your will be done in every heart and life. Thank you for meeting with us. Thank you for speaking to hearts. And I pray holy decisions are made for Thee today, Lord. Pray no one will hold back or resist You, but they'll do and be yielded to what You want to do in each one of our hearts. Have Your way now in this invitation time, and I'll thank You for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand, the pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this morning, will you?
Oh, soul, are you That's right. weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, He passed and we follow Him there. Over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, He promised. Believe Him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, His perfect salvation to tell. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of
His glory and grace.
Be seated for a minute, if you would, please. Getting Brent's information down here. Okay. You can get the rest of it later if you need it. Okay. Thank you. This is Brent Irvin, and Brent's right here. Let's see. Brent, you are going to be 22, right? Congratulations. Yesterday, Brother Chuck, I think, and Scotty went by just knocking doors. Oh, okay. All right. Standing outside, and they gave the gospel to Brent, and he accepted Christ as his Savior. And making his public profession of faith this morning, and is going to follow the Lord in baptism today as well. Amen? Isn't that great? So, Brent, congratulations to you. You follow Brother Bob Wallace right here. He'll take you downstairs and get you all set, and we'll be down there shortly, and we'll get ready to have him obey the Lord in baptism. That's great. Praise the Lord. All right, Brother Bob.
All right, let's sing a few favorites this morning. Anybody have a song we haven't sung for quite a while? Elijah? 211. 211. 211. Do you know this one, or you just thought it'd be a neat one to sing? You know it, or you just thought it would be a neat one to sing? We'll try it, huh? Okay, I have heard it. Okay, let's try it. Here we go. Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hearts to heaven and praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hearts to heaven and praise the Lord. That's not bad. Let's do it again. Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hearts to heaven and praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hearts to heaven and praise the Lord. Very good, Charles. 264. 264. He is able to deliver thee. 'Tis the grandest theme. Let's sing that first together. 'Tis the grandest theme through the ages rung. Our God is able to deliver thee. He is able to deliver thee. He is able to deliver thee. Though by sin oppressed, go to him for rest. Our God is able to deliver thee. Very good. Mrs. Jarvis. 91. 91. What a day, glorious day that will be. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come. No more clouds in the sky. No more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. Have the joy. 150. He lives. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. He lives. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how, I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
This is Brent Irvin. And Brent, upon a public profession of your faith in Christ as your Savior, and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bearing the likeness of Jesus' death, and raised in the likeness of his life. Amen. And the servant said, Master, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room.
Amen.
Very good. Let's do a couple more songs. Diane, did you have one? 488? All right. A new name in glory. Amen. I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has... For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. Katie, do you have one? 275. Verse 4, 275. It is well, I believe. It is well with my soul. Verse 4. And Lord, haste the day. And Lord, haste the day when the face shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. All right. Ushers, would you get the gifts we have for the ladies? They're in the sound room, I believe. Or no, you have them right there? All right. We want to make sure every mom gets one of these. If you're a mother, if you would raise your hand until you receive one. It's a little a manicure set, I guess. I think if I remember right, it has a little file and a buffer and all those neat things you do with your nails. So, guys, if you'll get those out, and then once you get one, you can put your hands down. That way we'll know you got one, all right? Amen. Very good. All right. They're all the same. Let's keep on rolling here.
Blood runs out of your arm. Put it down.
Wow. Okay, I got this middle row, middle section too. Pastor, you're right on ahead.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. That's what it is. All right. I have no idea what it is, but it's supposed to be something you can use. Thank you. I've never been accused of one. All right. Well, I'm glad I came this morning. Good to be in the house of the Lord. Hope you have a great Mother's Day. And let's be back tonight, okay? 6:30 for the evening service. And we'll have a great time in the fellowship time afterwards, okay? Let's stand together, shall we? Father, we thank you, Lord, for a wonderful morning this morning. Thank you for Brent and for his public profession of faith today in Christ. And, Lord, for following you in baptism. Thank you, Lord, for faithful soul winners that go out to give the gospel to people. Lord, we pray now you'll help this young man to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us to encourage him. Help him to be faithful, Lord, and to see what you will do in his life in the days to come. And Father, dismiss us with your care and watch over us throughout the day. And some will be traveling and such, and I pray you'll give them journey mercies. And Lord, bring us back safely for our services this evening. It's in Christ's name we do ask it. Amen. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God, Brother Bob.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.